MOTORHEAD! And we're gonna kick your ass!
I'm Matt McCourt from US Metal TV, and I can tell you that my most favorite day shooting bands was the first time we shot Motorhead in Portland, Oregon, 1999, at the Roseland Theater. And Lemmy, we got to interview him. Lemmy is just the best. Lemmy told me stories about Hendrix and selling acid to Hendrix and the scene in London in the 60s and the Beatles. And he was just the coolest guy. And when he found out that Dean and Mickey D knew each other and that I was a bass player that sang, he went and grabbed his bass and gave it to me and said, "Here, check this one out." It was the first year the Lemmy model Rickenbacker was released. And I asked him questions about the pickups, because I said, "Rickenbacker pickups always squeal. You can't really turn it up super loud. So these are special." And said, "Let's go up and plug it in at the sound check." And we're going to go to that footage right now. And I put my video camera down to play his bass when he plugged in and handed it to me again and said, "Here." So I started to play the first opening notes of Ace of Spades. He grabs the neck and said, "No, any song but that one, man." So I played the Villa from Dr. Mastermind. And the drum tech, Vito DeVito, who was up there checking the drums, he started playing along to the song because he was in a band with Kurt James. And it was just a great day for me. The guys in Hatebreed, Hatebreed was also on the bill, and I knew them from Victory Records. I've done some work for them before and introduced them to Tom Roberts, or Pig Champion from Poison Idea, who was walking on the street outside barefoot with a bottle of Thunderbird. I hailed him over. I said, "Come over, man." And he shows up and he goes, "Hey, McCourt, what's going on?" I go, "Come in and talk to Lemmy." And so he came in, met Lemmy, and I introduced him. I said, "This is, have you ever heard of Poison Idea?" And they said, "Yeah." I mean, they were looking kind of shocked, the guys in Hatebreed. And I said, "This is Pig Champion." "Oh, we know." They got down and did the Wayne's World, "I'm Not Worthy."
"Come on now. No guitar, no guitar, no guitar."
What's up? This is Jamie.
And Sean.
From Hatebreed, and you're watching US Metal.
Okay.
You rolling?
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to run.
Okay. You should say how much about Hatebreed.
Why should I do that? You've got to promote yourself, man. You're second on the bill tonight. What are you complaining about? Hey, I just cut the fourth band they were going to put on here. They were going to do it again.
Oh, yeah. the
That's how smart they are. After last night, they're going to do it again.
Yeah. So you cut it off?
The fucking hell are you?
The band
that
played for fucking 2 hours last night?
Did they?
The very first band?
I know they played a long story, it wasn't 2 hours. You're exaggerating. Shut up. But I mean, you know, and then they tell the drop kicks they got like 15 minutes?
Oh, yeah.
Who's going to sit still for that, man? No fucking body.
We only played.
20, wasn't it? 25?
Yeah, 18. They cut us off.
Well, at least you get to play your best date. What the fuck? Leave
ready?
Him smiling. Sorry, go.
Okay, cool. Welcome to the...
Don't rustle.
Never even
you're rustling.
Okay. Welcome to Volcano Magazine interview.
Thank you, sir.
For finally making it to Portland. That's great.
Finally, we've been here before.
Exactly. We'll phrase the question.
Okay.
I think the last time is the time that the tour didn't come through, I think, with Wasp.
Ah, yes. Well,
that was a crazy tour.
Nobody could expect me to put up with that asshole.
Yeah.
I agree.
More than legend, flesh and blood can stand.
A legend in his own mind.
In his own lunchtime, yes.
Yes. Did you play in any bands before Hawkwind? Did you make any recordings way back when you first started?
Yeah, there's a band called Sangapal, which was amplified tablas for some reason. Probably because I saw it could play. It was this band, you know, couldn't say anything. And there was a band called the Rocking Beckers, the Reverend Black and the Rocking Beckers. That was an interesting band. Used to dress in Finnish national costume and dog collars and reindeer skin boots and smash everything up. That was a good show.
What kind of music? Was it hard rock then?
Well, you couldn't call it hard rock. It was just rock and roll, you know. But it liked the Who kind of.
You're at the age band like me where you remember bands like Alex Harvey Band, a band before their time. It's too bad.
I'm after it.
Did you guys ever do any gigs with them?
Yeah, we did one in Germany once, I believe, but it was a long time ago.
Unbelievable stuff. Why did you leave Hawkwind to pursue Motorhead? Just
they fired me. It was a good time to split.
Do you have any favorite cities to play or countries?
I like the ones where they go hooray. I don't like the others. You know, I don't mind where it is. It doesn't matter what accent it's in. You know.
Also, your craziest moment or your rowdiest moment on stage? Yeah, I'm sure you have plenty. One that stands out?
I got a blowjob once on stage. That was a high spot, you know what I mean? Because usually they come up and like mime it and go away again, you know. This one actually got it out and did it, you know. Yeah, it was pretty good. I had my guitar higher in those days. Or at least I suddenly did anyway, you know.
But just the roadies let her go right on stage and do it, I guess.
Let her? I'd like to see him try and stop it.
Okay.
I would have killed him, never mind.
Okay. Certain fans get by. Okay.
Women always get an address from you, man. It's just guys we have to infect, you know.
Exactly. This question I was going to ask you, but it just came to mind, is like you traveled on the first Aussie tour when Randy Rhoads was around. Yeah. Did you guys get to meet and do things?
I played Asteroids all the way across America with Randy Rhoads. And I beat him every fucking time. He was not very good at that. He was a nice guy, you know, small.
Just had his anniversary of his death, I believe, and then also...
I really don't care about that. He became a better guitarist after he died, same as Buddy Holly, you know, and like Ricky Nelson. I mean, it doesn't matter, you know, he was a good guitar player, but he wasn't great. I mean, he wasn't earth-shattering, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, you guys...
He wasn't exactly Hendrix.
Exactly.
You know?
Speaking of that, you used to work for him, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah. I'm telling you about Hendrix, man. I mean, I was Randy Rhoads on the side of the stage, and I was Hendrix. It was a whole different fucking ballgame, you know. I mean, they were not comparable in any way, you know. I mean, Hendrix changed the way everybody played.
Yeah.
Everybody. Exactly. He changed Eric Clapton's way of playing.
I interviewed Tommy Chong recently, and he said that Jimi Hendrix came up in Canada in the 60s, and they had a topless club they turned into a comedy club, and they jammed there, and Jimmy says, I'd like to jam with you. He goes, I only got one guitar, so he says, I'll play bass. Right. So he's got Jimmy playing bass, and it's just something that he possesses, and he's just nostalgia that...
Yeah, he can play guitar upside down anyway. He can play anyway.
He's the best.
He's unbelievable.
I love that.
He's the best you'll ever see. I mean, you can't really hear it on records. You can hear what he's doing and it's great, but you can't understand it until you see the film of him live. And even then you weren't there. You know what I mean? To see that guy do a double somersault and come up still playing. You know what I mean? Yeah. He was good, man. And the chicks were going nuts for him.
When Captain Sensible was here, the guy in the Damned, he was telling a lot of stories about him because he goes way back, and he said that a lot of people were very racist and prejudiced against Jimmy coming to England. Like they couldn't believe that he was like so good all of a sudden.
To show you that the captain wasn't fucking there, you know. Because they weren't, you know.
Everybody really loved him and was really supportive.
Yeah, I mean, England, he couldn't... Actually, if he would have played crap from his second album onwards, he couldn't have gone wrong in England. We loved him, you know. And that was where he made his name, you know.
Did you ever get a chance to go in the studio play with him or jam with him?
I played with him once on a rehearsal where Noel never showed up, you know. I just played bass for about a half-hour blues jam. I mean, no singing, just playing, you know. Kind of boring from a bass player's point of view, but that's why he had Noel doing it, you know.
Exactly.
I was there at all the sessions for Axis Bold as Love.
Wow, that must have been great. That was history. What did you grow up listening to? Did you have any favorites?
The Beatles were the best.
Beatles?
No contest.
It's about the same. I just turned 50. You're going to be in the same age area. So we both. Did you listen to any surf music? Did that get over there?
Dick Dale was good. Early Beach Boys was good.
How about like the old stuff, like even like the Frankie Avalon or the Beach flunky stuff. Well, all that stuff came
out. D.D. Dinah was good, but after that, I thought he went downhill rather swiftly. You know?
Yeah, everything changed. I mean, music went, you know, when Beach Boys came out,
When the Bobbies came in, you know, Bobby this and Bobby that, like Jerry Lee Lewis says, there's Bobby this and Bobby that.
Yeah. Well, I was lucky to see all the early English stuff over in Lowell, Massachusetts, in Commodore Ballroom. I saw the original Fleetwood Mac 10 years after. Right. I saw Rod Stewart when he had Brown here.
Right. The original Fleetwood Mac was great, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Peter Green.
Yeah. He just recently came through town. He's got a few problems from past. A few problems. Yeah.
That's being kind.
Yeah. I don't want to slam him, but he's great. He's slow in reacting, but he's fantastic.
You can't slam him because it's not his fault, you know?
Yeah.
But like, I remember I had a girlfriend who used to work in the speakeasy, and her friend was Patty Bygraves, who was married to Dave, the drummer from Chicken Shack, right?
Yeah, I remember Chicken Shack.
That whole circuit, that English blues thing, you know, Fleetwood Mac and everybody.
Albert Lee,
Chicken Shack, and all them people. And I remember seeing Peter Green dressed in this white outfit, you know, like fucking Buddha, you know. And he was saying, man, everything will come to you if you just, you know, own and all this, you know. I thought he's headed for a breakdown right there, you know, and that was then. This is like 68 I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And sure enough, he went straight down the hole. I mean, he used to hang out at this rehearsal place that Motorhead started rehearsing at when he first started, and he was just gone. Stand by the window looking for things, you know.
he's
just nuts.
He just recently played a show upstairs where the other band is playing tonight, and it took him a while to get things together to sing, but you never know until he spoke later. And he was very slow moving, but I imagine that comes from either just...
He's had a lot of medication, you know.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, he attacked his accountant with a gun for sending him money. Send me any more money and I'll kill you, son of a bitch.
He was a great artist.
Yeah, he was. It's a shame.
You know, and that we could go on about Sid Barrett, too, I'm sure.
The whole thing, yeah. Well, on the tour I did with Hendrix of England, we had The Move with the original five.
Remember
members,
The Move.
Hendrix. Pink Floyd with Sid Barrett, his last tour. Amen Corner. The Nice with Davey Ollust. And the band that became the Grease band, Heir Apparent.
Exactly.
That's a good tour, right, for 7 and 6?
Exactly. Well, I saw something kind of like that. I saw The Crazy World of Arthur Brown back with Super Session with Al Kooper. And Crazy World of Arthur Brown, I was wondering if he was all there because he would pop through hoops and...
We just seen him.
Did you?
He came to see a show about 6 months ago. Yeah, he was actually all right.
Now, he was ahead of his time, I thought. He had all the Aussie makeup on earlier before.
Well,
Aussie
I mean, even... Arthur was messed up, you know, then. I mean, we all were. I mean, everybody was tripping. Everybody. That was the time, you know. That's what happened. We all just
when the Beatles went through that change, and is when England went through that change, pretty much.
I mean,
everybody started experimenting.
The Beatles took half-times, and what could it do to you, right?
Everybody started experimenting with psychedelics, I heard, in those days, and Sid went overboard. But
well, it weren't that bad, you know. Mm-hmm. It's better than it is now with heroin.
You guys, I'm sure, had your own version of Woodstock and Haight-Ashbury over in England, kind of.
Yeah, we had the Isle of Wight festivals, yeah. 69 and 70. Bob Dylan headlined the first one, and Hendrix headlined the second. Mm-hmm. He was terrible, Hendrix. I mean, I'd never seen him so bad. I was sitting on the hillside watching him in the middle of the night by the time he went on, and I just thought, fuck you, you're done. You know, and he was dead, he was late.
All those deaths. It's so sad, especially
well,
Jim
maybe
Morrison over there.
A lot of the time it isn't as sad as if they would have carried on. You know?
What would they be doing today?
Well, Jim Morrison wouldn't be doing anything, would he? He'd have his mind by now. Yeah. He was pretty well close to the band. Hendrix would be playing shit because he was in the end anyway. You know?
Like I said, in those days I was lucky enough to see some early concerts. Probably one of the most rarest ones was the Yardbird lineup with Jimmy Page playing rhythm and back on guitar. Yeah. I had to wear a tie and a coat in Salem, New Hampshire to get in to see this, and it was great. And who knows that this guy would have a super band later, you know, Jimmy playing rhythm on. But you could tell, like, stars were being born there when you saw this stuff. And, of course, you know, I saw the early Fleetwood Mac lineup. What else? You know, Fleetwood Mac when they had all guys that people don't know, you know.
People don't even remember that.
The early Kinks.
Yeah.
It was great. The original Kinks. All that stuff played
there.
And then we had that big wave of Freddie and the Dreamers and Herman's Hermits and all that.
I know.
What happened there?
Well, they were novelty in England, you know. They became huge stars there, but they were just novelty after England.
Yeah, exactly. So, Lemmy, do you have any favorite new 90s bands?
Skunk Anansie.
Skunk and Anne's. I think I remember her. One of the girls kind of looked like out of Bow Wow Wow.
One of the girls? Oh,
was there a girl singer?
There's only one.
Yeah, okay. I've heard of them. I don't think I've seen them live, but I heard they're a great band.
Well, you messed up then.
Yeah.
You're being old and elitist. You should go see them. They're fucking marvelous.
They're still playing then?
They're still playing.
They're out there doing albums.
Some of their third album right now.
Oh, okay.
You should get their albums. They're really worth buying. Yeah. Full price, even over the price.
Did they open for you guys anytime?
No.
Okay.
No, we went to see them in France when we were touring. We were in the same city one night, so we went after our show and saw them. They're fucking excellent. And their albums are great. She's got a voice that would, like, lay you straight out on the floor. I mean, I'm hard to impress, man. I've seen the Beatles live, you know, and all that.
Yeah.
I'm hard to fucking impress. I saw, like, Gene Vincent live and Eddie Cochran live and Buddy Holly live, you know.
Yeah. I saw the Beatles live, too, in Boston Garden. I was 14th row, but I couldn't hear shit. And I was real mad because...
Yeah, but it's the event, you know.
But just to see them in front of me was just like...
Just to be able to say I was there and the Beatles were in real living color in front of me.
Exactly.
Right?
I went to the original Woodstock. I told my dad I was going to the drive-in for the weekend, and I turned back the speedometer. That's a good trick because if nobody knows how to do that...
Those are the days, huh?
Yeah, what you do is like, hey, Dad, I'm just going to drive and I might camp overnight if I drink, you know, and I was going to Woodstock. And I told him that 20 years later, and he goes, I knew it.
I knew that. I saw you in the movies, in the newsroom.
Yeah, I saw you.
You were that one with the joint guy.
Yeah, but we went prepared. We went like with food and everything. We ended up giving away a lot of food to people that just went like homeless hippies, you know. But it was just sharing and sharing alike. And then when you tried to go buy hot dogs, people were either selling them for like 50 cents full and cooked. Right. And otherwise, people were selling raw hot dogs for $3 a piece. They would scam anybody.
And you cook them, you know. Yeah.
Well, we couldn't even, you know. Sometimes
there was a 250,000 people, though, for 3 days and no fights.
Oh, yeah. It was unbelievable.
That's unbelievable, man. So, yeah. You know, people can't grasp it.
Yeah, now they go to school with guns.
Yeah.
To get the people to feed them, they were dropping oranges and light,
And people are like treating that thing, kids go to school with a gun, as a social problem. It's insane, right? That is when you've lost control completely of your children.
Well, the Chili Peppers are coming here next week, and they're doing a show where, to get into their show, nobody can get in except high school kids, and they have to write an essay on how you can stop violence.
Right.
I think that's great that the band's taking issue to that.
Yeah, but I don't think it's going to do any good, do you?
Would you trust an 18-year-old?
Just paying lip service to it. You know, if you raise him, what would you think of that? You think, shit, fuck,
Well, we were brought up in different age bands. I wouldn't want to be 18 today, you know, with all this age shit and all this.
Still less 17.
We used to have any kind of disease, you could rub it away, or it's kind of...
Or you could go and get an injection and never get rid of it.
Yeah, or the cotton swabby job or whatever.
I mean, I tried the rhythm method, but apparently I couldn't keep a beat because I had to touch it.
What I was going to say is, so as far as 90s bands go, the new music, gothic music, all the stuff that's breaking different directions, do you think...
breaking what different directions?
Well, you get the gothic music that's been big lately, you know, of course...
I've seen it. Yeah. Most of it, twice.
Yeah. You know, it's been done before.
I've been in rock and roll a long time, and all I found out that there's nothing new since, like, Buddy Holly and Eddie Cochran. There's nothing new.
So it's been recreated.
Yeah, it's just comes around again, and they dress it up, or they dress different, or they have different hair, you know, but it's the same music. It's rock and roll, man. Yeah. It's unbeatable. You can't stop it. And why should you want to?
Alice Cooper did a bio the other day on VH1, and I was hoping he would say, like, yeah, these so-called bands like Marilyn Manson.
I know,
No, but he never did.
They think they're decadent.
Oh, yeah, they're just...
They're trying too hard, you know.
Yeah, but they're making it, so... That's stupid.
Well, that's fair enough. You know, we're not supposed to understand it because we're gone now. Yeah. We're the old people now.
Oh, you know, I try not to think that. We were mid-age.
Yeah, but you have to get used to it.
Yeah.
Because it's true. Because if you were 18, you wouldn't fucking listen to anybody who was 30. Never mind 50.
I wouldn't give up my lifestyle of growing up with all that great music.
Oh, me either, you know. But you can't expect people to understand it.
Yeah.
Or be sympathetic to it or anything.
Some of them should.
Yeah. I mean, they say they are, but they can't grasp what we did. They don't understand it like on a ground roots level thing. They don't know how it felt, and you can't communicate how it felt. Yeah. And why should you want to anyway? You know, it's their time now. They can have their time.
Some younger friends went to Woodstock, and they... the Woodstock too, and they said that it was great. I could see how you felt with the mud and all the drugs.
No,
and I says, no, it was a whole different world. I mean, it was like
people were different.
Yeah, at 7 in the morning when Hendrix came on. See, they were running bands back to back because of schedule.
Right.
So you couldn't get any sleep if you did. Like, you know, they put folk singers on all night, but music ran constantly, maybe an hour or two break. And And then, like, Airplane or somebody come on, like, Who came on at 1:32 in the morning? You know, people never believe that. They're that late? I says, yeah. And Hendrix came on.
But where are you going to go?
Yeah.
And if you're in the middle of a 250,000 people, you're not going to go for a piss. Get a piss down your leg, right? I mean, that's it.
People did
place.
Pretty much relieve themselves around, you know, because it was all clay mud. It was wet. You couldn't tell. And some people were gross, and some people used the outhouses. But
just
by that time,
in, right?
By the time, the outhouses, you had to swim to those because of the red clay mud. Not only that, at that time, it was so mellow that you could walk 50 to 75 feet from the front of the stage and not get squashed in those days.
And you could also have your placement ready for you when you come back.
Exactly. People laying out blankets and sinking into the mud, but there was no, like, shoving and pushing. So that's how that changes in those days. And kids can't, what do you mean? You could really get that close to the stage and see Hendrix? Yeah. So that was great, and I thought that was nice. I already asked you what you grew up listening to, I guess. And what was the first band you ever saw in concert?
Billy Fury. It's a name that nobody knows anymore. He was the English rock and roll star. He was the English Elvis kind of.
Another early guy, too, was the guy that used to sing for The Who a little, the big heavyset guy with the big pompadour. I can't remember his name, though.
For The Who?
No, he just sang on the reunion tour with Billy Idol and those people. Gary Glitter.
Oh, Gary.
Yeah. Gary was a big-time guy. I guess like the early Elton John type thing. Liberace, maybe, of England.
Gary was kind of another novelty act, you know.
He was.
Yeah.
But he was...
A couple of hit singles.
He was bigger in England than here.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he never meant to think he had anything.
Yeah.
Cliff Richard, the same thing. I mean.
You have a new album.
Mm. Yeah, we do. Everything louder than everyone else. I found it in the truck stop last night. Good. Good deal.
Great. Let's see. Everybody wants me to ask this question, especially the publisher. What's your favorite beer? Let me see if I can guess.
I bet you can't.
Guinness? No. Okay.
Not even close. And it's not German.
Okay. I don't know. I'm not a real... I remember just Guinness and... like,
Foster's?
Not Foster's.
Foster's ain't bad, but it's...
Heineken?
No,
that's German. Okay.
No, it's Dutch.
Oh, that's Dutch. Okay.
My favorite beer is a beer you can't get anywhere but England. It's called Special Brew. Carlsberg made it for Winston Churchill after the war. It's a special brew.
Okay.
And that's the only place you can buy it is England, so...
Really?
Don't look forward to getting any soon. Because, I mean, they couldn't make it here. It's 9% proof. So they wouldn't be allowed to even brew it in America.
So it's like, what percentage of alcohol is it?
9%.
Woo! Oh, that'll kick your ass.
You can try Oregon's beers.
You like the micro-brews?
No.
Don't like them at all?
It tastes like shit. I mean, if you're going to make beer, why not make it palatable? You know, I mean, it's ever so strong. Yeah, it tastes like cough medicine, you know. I mean, I don't see the point, really.
A word on Thin Lizzy, guys. You were around in those days, too. Phil was a guy ahead of his time. That's sad that he passed on.
Yeah.
And Gary's kind of carrying... Well, Gary was never original, but Gary Moore is a nice guy. A friend of mine, by the way, who would have liked to said Heidi. I didn't get a hold of him. He might be out of town, but he sang with Gary Moore on G-Force.
Oh, yeah?
Had a rough time. Yeah, his name was Willie D. Willie Daffron.
Right.
Yeah. He, I'm trying to get a hold of him, see if he'll come down to the show, because he knows he's met you. He knows you guys from before. He toured opening for Whitesnake with the G-Force. And
which kind of been easy?
I think so, yeah. And he was telling me great stories about Sharon's father.
Don Arden, I.
Oh, yeah, he says.
Hanging Steve Marriott out of the balcony by one leg.
He says they took life insurance out on the band right before they went on. He says, you guys better put on a good tour or else. So they did.
You're fucking dead, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm sure you got stories about
that.
That's
where Sharon learned all her craft from.
But he did do a lot with a lot of bands. I guess he introduced...
Yeah, they're all the ones that said, we were robbed afterwards.
Did you ever know Peter Grant, Led Zeppelin?
Yeah.
He was a rough and tough guy.
Yeah.
But he got the job done.
I mean, Zeppelin were assholes, actually. You know, in the early days, people thought they were gangsters, you know. They used to walk around with these fedoras on and shit, you know, being like tough guys. And they beat a guy to death at the San Francisco Fillmore. Stagehand, he told Peter Grant's kid to fuck off because the kid was fucking with the ropes and shit. And he said, fuck off, kid. John Benden and, what's his name?
That was on a report on the Led Zeppelin show. They almost beat the security guy to death. They took him back and bloodied him.
They did beat him to death.
They did beat him to death.
Yeah,
wow.
He died. Stagehand.
That's because they messed with the kid.
Yeah, because he told the kid to fuck off because he was messing with the ropes that were holding things up. Like you would, right?
Yeah.
Fuck off, kid. You know, that's all he did.
Recently, there was like a stories about that where they did stuff like where they there was a thrash show where one of the guys of a new band, I can't remember what it was, like Pennywise, one of those skateboard bands, was jumping into the crowd, and sometimes security forgets they come from the crowd or the singer, and the guy tried to come back on stage being the lead singer, and the guy tackled him and tried to throw him back in the crowd, and this guy knocked out the security.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean,
and there was no charges pressed because he was throwing the lead singer back out of the audience. He didn't know. He said he looked like every other fan. He thought he was just running back up to jump and attack the band.
Well, he should have noticed singer. He was on stage behind him, actually.
Exactly. He should have watched him jump out and kept an eye on him. That's his job.
That's his gig.
Yeah. I worked security for, in fact, I worked security and took photos of your shows when you opened at the Paramount Theater way back when. That was a great
way
show.
Back.
Yeah, the big bomber hanging on stage.
That was Crocus.
That's right. That's off of the bill.
But I think
Crocus and Fest.
And it was like the first week you had
Brian Robertson.
Yeah.
But you opened for Ozzy one time.
Yeah.
Yeah. You had the bomber on stage, didn't you, when you first opened? Or was that
the
headline?
Ozzy. That was the one.
Yeah. I remember that.
That's like in San Francisco at the Waldorf.
The old Waldorf.
Yeah. That was a
good show. Yeah. I got that on tape somewhere. That's a bootleg now.
Yeah. So, hey, if you could do a studio project with any musicians, anybody at all, you know, just say you wanted to do a good best of super session type thing, who would you pick and why? You know?
Jeff Beck, because he's Jeff Beck.
Yeah. He's been the most underrated musician in a long time, I
sure
think.
Sure has. He played a lot of shit, too. You know, it's his own fault. All that jazz stuff is all very well if you call us Santana, you know, but I think these people vanish up their own asshole, you know. I mean, what he was good at was like shapes of things, you know. It was his best moment for me. And Mr. You're a Better Man Than I, you know, I mean, he was a wonderful rock guitar player. And then he goes twiddling off into that jazz thing, same as Santana, you know, who was a magic blues guitar player. And they just wasted themselves, as far as I'm concerned. I'm sure the jazz community got more out of them than me, you know, but there we go.
Do you like the new stuff, like Satriani and Vibe?
Well, I've got no time for all this twiddly stuff, you know, freaking guitar players showing off. I like songs, you know, not showcases for the guitarist, you know. I don't care how much spandex they wear, you know. Yeah. I like the Beatles, you know, they were my big pet influence, and they wrote fucking songs. I mean, whoever was top of the heap at the moment they wrote that song, at least it was still a song that they all joined in, you know.
Yeah.
They weren't just like waiting for the solo, you know, which is bullshit for
me. So, were you like me? Don't you wish the bullet kind of went 2 more inches to the right when it shot John?
Yeah, right, there you go. What was I going to say? Yeah, Jeff Beck. On drums, I can't think of anybody better than Mickey, you know, out of my band.
Yeah,
band in it anyway.
Mickey's from King Diamond's band, isn't he?
Yeah.
Way back.
Yeah. He was with Dokken too.
That's right. But I think his claim to fame or something was first with Merciful Fader with King Diamond. I remember seeing him there first. Which is a much better music he's playing. I mean, that's good music, don't get me wrong. King Diamond's another guy that still survives and gets out and plays.
Lemmy was a great interview subject. Paul Kearney is the guy that is interviewing Lemmy, and I think we got a clip of him, right? Okay. So Paul Kearney was interviewing him for Volcano Magazine, which was a skateboard magazine at the time, and he asked him all the questions, and then I asked him some questions about Jimi Hendrix, and the interview took off to a different part, and yeah, it was just a great day. And so for all of you people who are asking about this, here it is. Part 2 of the Lemmy Kilmister interview from Portland, Oregon on U.S. Metal.
Speaking of sounds, your bass sound is, it's a trademark.
Yeah, people keep saying, what effects do you use? And I hate to tell them I don't use any. It depresses the shit out of them, you know. And out buying 25 pedals and they still haven't got it, you know. You don't need pedals, man, you know. If you got an amplifier that's worth the name, then you can do it on that, you know. Old Marshalls, that's the trick. New Marshalls ain't worth fuck all.
Do you just use 412s?
412s and 415s each stack. And 100 watt JMP Super Bass 2. The old Marshall amp, 70s Marshall amp.
Do you prefer any type of strings? You know your bass.
Just medium gauge, you know.
Yeah.
You haven't seen the new Rickenbacker, have you? Wayne!
Yeah?
Get Tim to bring my bass down here. Yeah?
That'd be great, yeah, if you could hold that for close. Where do you reside now? In the States or in England?
Los Angeles, yeah.
Los Angeles, yeah. Much better. No, hardly less taxes, craziness of the world.
Well, it's a lot more fun with the climate there, you know, than it is in England. It's the same climate as here, right, England?
Exactly, yeah. We've heard you really love the rainbow. Everybody always sees you there.
I know they do, don't they? Although I'm very often not there because I'm out of the country for 8 months of the year for a start. Right? Yeah. So.
I love Los Angeles. A lot of people think it's plastic. It's who you know and where you go, you know. I mean, it's...
Whether a place is good or not depends entirely on who you're with, good. Right?
I was brought up in New Hampshire, and I went to Boston all the time, so all the early Celtics. I knew Aerosmith before they were signed.
They were good. They supported Oakland runs.
They what?
Aerosmith supported Hawkwind once.
Yeah.
So did Rush.
Really?
Rush supported Hawkwind a few times too.
Really?
And the first tour we ever did of America, the Aerosmith, Rush, and Mahogany Rush supporters.
Did you like playing the Hawkwind music?
Yeah.
I mean, it was kind of like an early Pink Floyd ahead of its time. And
oh, we weren't like Pink Floyd, man. We were like a black fucking nightmare. We used to lock the doors so those people couldn't get out. We had five strobes at eye level on the crowd, none on the band. Right. Hey, Mick. Want to be on TV, mate?
What?
Want to be on TV?
How you doing?
He's a good-looking one, you know.
What?
He's a good-looking one.
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
so he says. You leave
working
up?
Hong Kong.
What are you doing?
So,
here?
What keeps Motorhead rolling? Just basically the fans and nothing's changed.
Just the fact that we want to do it, you know.
Exactly.
We didn't get sick of it yet.
And fuck the record companies. Do this certain type of album, or do a ballad. Yeah.
I mean, it's hardly time to start listening to record companies at this point in the game.
Oh yeah.
25 years in.
Yeah. Especially with the year too. And anything planned for the year 2000? Any special concerts coming up?
Yeah, we're going to explode on stage. Yeah. A shower of vital parts.
Would that happen, like in Spinal Tap, that it burned a couple of times? Did you guys like that, or was that kind of a joke?
I thought it was funny. Yeah, it was pretty close to the truth.
To the reality.
I've seen people with that, you know, the cheese doesn't fit the bread. You know, I've seen people like that.
Well, those guys, it's hard to believe that they were American actors, you know, the way they did that so perfect.
Two
and stuff.
English,
I guess. Yeah. But
they got to 11.
Yeah, exactly.
Wouldn't it just be easier to make the 10 louder and just have 10?
That is how guitar
they got to 11.
That's how a guitar player is.
That's how ours is.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that you know, people have, you know, they're supposed to come out of those like eggs or those things, and it gets stuck in a room. Finally, when he opens it, it's the end of the song, and then they get lost in the basement, like these old buildings. You
know,
like,
I know, that's perfect. Up. I mean, we've been in a place like that. Where was it? St. Louis, I think. Where we had to go under the stage and then into
Pink
the cellar. Pink Palace,
Essen.
Hamburg, yeah.
Essen.
Right.
We got lost there.
Fucking incredible. We come off stage, man, we were in the kitchen, right? We came up in the kitchen in two different places and we couldn't recognize it. We went back down again.
The dressing room is on the other side of the hall, theater. Mm-hmm. And you have to go down and underneath the actual floor where...
And the Germans are great diggers, you know. There's about 30 different corridors, right? It's like a labyrinth.
Amazing.
Came across the Minotaur twice.
Exactly. You guys like to ride a lot of bikes on your spare time? You ride?
No,
you don't
ride
bikes.
Yes,
I do.
Do you?
Death traps, yeah.
They can be, yeah. I've had a lot of friends wipe out on them. But
people drive right over them, you know. Don't see them.
In these days and age, you know what I mean? You don't even want to, like, cut somebody off and then, you know, give them the finger. Them. Boom. You know? Oh, yeah. These truck drivers, you hear stories about them now, these kids. Cut them off and think it's funny, and then they chase them down and shoot through their window. They did that up here, you know. God, what are they thinking? Anyway, well, that's just about it. What I was going to ask you is a couple more things. Is like, is the tour going to last a long time this year, pretty much, or is it a world tour?
We're just touring this whole month, and then we go to Germany. We're doing festivals out of Germany, but we're in Germany recording for the next album.
Those have to be fun, the outside big festivals. I mean, more than a small club. I mean, sometimes you're lost, like in the crowd, and if you play...
They both have their own attractions, you know what I mean? Yeah. You don't get a good sound on stage on the festival usually, but it's the event, you know, which is all right.
It's the, you know, the crowd. That you get that many more Motorhead fans, you know, coming to you. And, you know, it's cool that you got the new bands, like the skateboard bands, like Hatebreed and Dropkick Murphys opening for you, because that's going to bring the younger kids in and listen to Motorhead. You know,
if we got a lot of young kids anyway, actually, you know,
they
come along, yeah.
So you got an all-age audience pretty much these days.
I seem to bring my bass down, of course, nothing's happening.
And you see fans older than us, probably, I'm sure. Probably
not 60, much older 60. Than you, no.
Yeah. Well, I don't feel like a big 50, but...
I know, you never do, it's funny, isn't it? Still, what are you talking about? I'm 24. Yeah.
Yeah. Seen a lot of new generation coming around the last couple of years.
Well, I've seen your previous bands a lot, too, you know, way back.
King Diamond Days.
Yeah, that was some great stuff. But I was talking to him about, do you remember, did you ever listen to any Alex Harvey band stuff?
With Megadeth?
Was just doing some great stuff.
I was on the opening band called Mayhem.
Oh, here?
Yeah.
86 or?
Yep.
Oh, man, that's a long time. Sorry, what did you say?
A long time ago now. I'm not getting any younger.
Just early Alex Harvey stuff. That was a band like it was doing kind of Kiss-type stuff. Well, not Kiss-type stuff, but Zell Clemmons had that.
One of them, yeah.
Yeah. And, of course, Crazy World of Arthur Brown, those guys, one guy dressed like a devil, I think one guy was like an executioner.
Drake and Thika.
Exactly.
Yeah. The hood over his face, yeah.
Yeah.
Couldn't see where he was playing.
Those are the good old days.
And I'm going to go take a shower, guys.
Okay. Yeah. Nice to meet you.
Right. Wake up. Take care. See you later. Right. Nice to see you again, though. Jesus, 86.
Yeah.
I'll do that. See you in Portland.
Oh, yeah, did you know Matt?
Oh, here he comes.
Did you know Matt used to be the singer for Wild Dogs?
Right. Yeah. I don't remember the band. I'm sorry, I don't know.
Well, I barely remember it, too.
This is the new Lemmy Rickenbacker signature bass.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Of course, it's beautiful. I designed it.
Wow. So is that a custom bass, or is that will that be a model
they're
going to...
They say they're going to produce it for public consumption, but they haven't yet. Should say Rickenbacker, I think, but we haven't got around to it. What do you think? Nice, huh?
Yeah, very nice. Nice. How did you have that style so it's different than other basses? It's just basically gold pickups and the sound that you had. See, I'm not a big guitar.
Well, these are the new Rickenbacker pickups, and this one's uneven, I might add.
What do you use, about four basses when you play? Different ones or about the same Rickenbacker?
No, I've just got two.
When I've had Rickenbackers, the pickups are squeal like.
Not these.
Shit.
These are great. They finally made a good pickup. You always had to change the pickups on Rickenbackers anyway, you know. I mean, I used to put Bartolini's on them, and I had to give some Thunderbird pickup on one of them.
Hmm.
Okay, so this is Tim, my guitar person.
Yeah. I was going to put some filter.
Although he was actually a guy.
Yeah. I was going to put some...
Person shit is very weird.
Yeah.
Lemmy, I was going to...
Can't tell if it's a man or a woman, but fuck's
sake. I was going to see if I could put some film in and get a shot of you with the guitar and the magazine, if that's okay with you. Let me... Give me about a minute and I'll load this thing. It's a point and shoot. It's quick.
It's supposed to be quick, huh?
Yeah. These things are quick.
Do you mind saying something here? Hi, Portland. I'm Lemmy, and you're watching Silver Star Video Magazine.
Hello, Portland. You're watching the Silver Star video for whatever reason you can think of, and I'm Lenny, and I'm stuck here in this room with this guitar, and I'm going to go up there soon and hit it really, really hard. And that's about the story, really. Aloha. Vaya con Dios.
Great, thanks. Can you get this bass?
You got the thing in front of you. You had the cord in front of the lens.
Yeah, I had it hanging over the
lens. It was right in front of the lens.
It was?
So you get a really good shot of a piece of black cord there.
Okay. Adds depth.
Adds depth. No, I mean,
it's age, you know. Age creeping up on the...
We all have that problem, yeah. Let me get one with the magazine, if that's great, and then there you go.
Yeah, I'm worried about losing my hair.
Do you like?
Yeah, that's great.
That was volunteer anyway, wasn't it?
Yep.
You can keep that if you like.
I could be a bald guy. A bald guy with long hair or a bald guy. So.
Or a long-haired bald guy.
Yeah. This way, I don't have to buy shampoo.
That's true. Mm-hmm. You have to buy more razor blades.
Yeah.
So anyways, that should have been a co-headliner last time with Wasp. I thought, you know, you guys
were a co-headliner.
Oh, you were?
Yeah, but they had to play last every night because it took so long to clean up the shit they made on stage.
Oh, they still went back to the bloody shit? And
yeah, and bursting pillows open with a sword, which I thought was really, you know, He-Man-like. You know, feathers everywhere.
The opening band was kind of, they've played here a lot.
They're great, the Important Sea Snakes, yeah.
They're funny guys. They're not afraid to get out and do crazy shit.
The Important Sea Snakes, right?
Yeah, that's great.
I thought they were great, yeah. I thought they were the best thing on the bill, actually.
Exactly. It's okay if I get a picture with you? Because I know probably later you'll be busy.
You guys want to
get one?
Maybe. It's pretty dark now.
Yeah, he can get one.
Yeah, I could live my whole life without Wasp.
Yeah, you, really.
Did you get a picture of us? Great, that's ready to shoot. You just hit the red button.
Hit the red button.
That blonde guitar guy was pretty cool. Was his name Chris Holmes?
Chris Holmes. Oh, the rest of the Wasp were all right. It was just Blackie.
Yeah.
Give me the 50-year-old thing.
Thank you very much. Sure. Let me thank your own company. Everything goes through him. No right. Tower Records. No. Right. Everything's the Michael Schenker company now. You got to order everything through him, which I don't blame him because he said things have gone rotten in the past.
Just robbery. You know.
Yeah. Well, when you're young like
they
that.
They steal all your money. I wouldn't mind if they just stole half of it.
Yeah.
You know, even two-thirds of it. Let you keep some, but they don't. They want it all.
Isn't that what happened to Jimmy and Janice? They get them so drugged up, they just say, okay, here's
nobody was
money.
Signing.
Yeah.
Motorhead's my favorite band. I own all the albums, and there's something about the bass sound really got me.
Thank you. This song is from Snakebite Love, everybody. What's the matter with these vocals? They're terrible. Take the bottom end off and put the top on it, eh? A 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 9, 9, number 9. It's called Take the Blame.
If you ever saw Motorhead live, you know what I'm talking about, and you'll know the feeling that happens after the show when your body is pelted with so much sound. And That's why music was so big back in the 60s, because the amps were so big and so loud and the PA systems couldn't keep up, that it was just that sound coming off of their amps that infiltrated your cells and made you feel it. And that's what made it so profoundly sexual, okay? It's not just listening to it, it's absorbing it. And that's exactly what Motorhead does. And if you've ever seen them in a club, I saw them at the old Waldorf in 1981. And wow, man, yeah, there's nothing like a wall of marshals that are just, you know, coming at you at full roar. And Fast Eddie and Animal and Lemmy just kicked it out, man. And boy, I was just buzzing for hours after, like almost a whole day. We drove home from California that night, and I can still remember I ate a hot dog at an AM/PM gas station that was too hot and burnt my insides. So between the burn and the buzzing of my insides, I'll never forget that feeling. That was on the Ace of Spades tour. It was amazing. It was like a day off from the Aussie tour, and they would do their own dates, and I'm so glad they did. We are so lucky to be in the right place one more time at the right time and saw them.
Thank you. I'm gonna make you smile. It's a love that won't have no sign. I'm gonna let you be around. Won't let you be around.